A quick demonstration of the heart after it has been eviscerated from the thoracic cavity in this cadaver. So what are the structures which are immediately visible in front of us? We can see the openings of the great vessels. So this is the aortic opening which has been cut here. This is the pulmonary opening. This is the atrial portion. This is the ventricular portion. We have removed the epicardium here. Epicardium is actually nothing but the visceral layer of the serous pericardium. Let's take a look at what we can see from the outside. When we look at the aortic opening, we can see three cusps of the valves, the right, left, and the posterior. And just above the cusps of the valves, we can see some small dilatation. So this is the right aortic coronary dilatation, left aortic coronary dilatation, and the posterior non-coronary sinus. From the right will arise the right coronary artery, from the left will arise the left coronary artery. And from the posterior sinus, aortic sinus, there will be no coronary arteries arising. That's why it's called the non-coronary sinus. If you take a close look at the margins of the valves, semilunar valves, the peripheral portion is attached to a fibrous structure known as the fibrous coronate. The free margin is known as the lunule, and the apex of the lunule is a thickened portion called the nodule, and that's what produces a watertight junction. The same principle applies to the pulmonary semilunar valves. Only thing is, in this particular cadaver, the three semilunar valves, the cusps are open. So this is the pulmonary outflow, and this outflow is referred to as the conus arteriosus or the infundibulum, and this is the aortic outflow, and that is known as the aortic vestibule. So this is what we see in this immediate view. Now let's take a look at the right atrium. This is the right atrium which we have split open by means of a T-shaped incision. And when we reflect it, we notice this ridged portion here. This ridged portion is the musculi pectinati, or the pectinate muscles. This is the anterior portion of the crista terminalis. And the smooth posterior portion of the behind the crista terminalis is known as the sinus venarium. And this is the inflow part where it is smooth, and this is the portion which is derived from the sinus venosus. So what are the structures which are opening into the sinus venarium part? We can see this opening here. This is the superior vena cava opening. The next thing that we can see is this opening here. This is the inferior vena cava opening. So superior vena cava opening is here, inferior vena cava opening is here. And joining the two, there is a shallow sulcus here, and that is known as the sulcus terminalis, which is matched by the crista terminalis on the inner surface. And this is the one which demarcates the muscular part from the smooth part. If you were to take a look at the opening of the inferior vena cava, we see these fibrous structures here. This is the remnant of a rudimentary valve, which is known as the valve of the inferior vena cava. Going further, we can see the opening of the coronary sinus, where my probe has gone in. And we can see again some fibrous valves there. That is known as the valve of the coronary sinus, also referred to as the Thamesian valve. So coronary sinus also opens into the right atrium near the interatrial septum. And at that place is the region of the AV node. The location of the SA node is at the upper end of the crista terminalis near the opening of the superior vena cava. So these are the structures that we can see in the right atrium. Now let's come to the left atrium. We can see the two right pulmonary, the two left pulmonary veins. And when we open it up, we can see the interior of the left atrium. And we can see that the entire interior of the left atrium is smooth. Now I'm going to put my finger into the left atrioventricular valve, and my finger has gone in through the mitral valve, and it is entered into the left ventricle. So we can see the two cusps, the anterior and posterior, and we can see the caudate tendine, and we can see the leaflets of the valves. Left ventricle wall is three times thicker than the right ventricular wall. And we can see that it is deeply ridged, and these ridges are known as trabeculae carnea. And when we look further inside, we can see that after the muscular ridges have finished, on the upper part is the smooth outflow part, and that outflow part is the outflow to the aorta. So therefore the blood travels from the left atrium vertically down into the left ventricle, and then it makes 180 degrees bend and comes out through the aorta. In contrast, let's open the right ventricle, which we have done here, and what do we see? We see three sets of valves, the anterior, posterior and septal, and we can see the caudate tendineae and we can see the papillary muscles. The blood flows from the right atrium, it moves horizontally through the atrioventricular or the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle, and then it makes a 90 degrees bend and it passes out through the pulmonary trunk. And this is the outflow part of the pulmonary, which is known as the infundibulum or the conus arteriosus. The junction between the rough muscular part and the smooth outflow part, this is known as the supraventricular crest. So these are the interior of the right atrium ventricle and the respective valves. This is the right auricle, this is the left auricle. Right auricle opens into the right atrium, left auricle opens into the left atrium. This is the site of wall thrombus in atrial fibrillation, which can give rise to stroke, especially when it is in the left circulation. What other structures that we see straight away on the external aspect, once we put everything in place? We can see this groove here, where my instrument is passing. This is the coronary groove. This is the anterior part of the coronary groove through which we will be running the coronary vessels, which I shall describe later. And when we turn the heart, we can see the posterior part of the coronary groove. This is all filled by various blood vessels, which we shall describe later. Anteriorly, we see this anterior interventricular groove. And when we trace it from just by the side of the apex of the heart, which is here, we can trace it and we can see this is the posterior interventricular groove. Where the posterior coronary groove meets the posterior interventricular groove, this region is known as the crux of the heart. And many vascular events take place at the crux of the heart, which I shall describe later. And finally, if I were to hold the heart in its anatomical position, the heart is held in your left hand with the hand dorsiflexed and radially deviated. So where my fingertip is located, this is the apex of the heart. And diametrically opposite to that, this is the region of the base of the heart. The base of the heart is found mostly by the left atrium and a little bit by the right atrium. So this is the anatomical location of the heart. Therefore, this is the sternocostal surface of the heart, which is formed mostly by the right ventricle. The left margin of the heart is formed by the left ventricle. The right margin of the heart is formed by the right atrium, and the inferior margin of the heart is formed by the right ventricle. The inferior or the diaphragmatic surface is where my hand was resting, and that is formed mostly by the left ventricle. So these are the parts of the heart and the respective ventricular relationships of the heart. And last but not the least, I'm going to put my finger in this plane here. My finger is in the transverse sinus. This is a very important procedure that the cardiac surgeon has to do before he performs the open heart surgery. The structures in front of my finger are the aortic outflow and the pulmonary outflow, pulmonary trunk and the aortic. And behind my finger is the superior vena cava. By doing this, then we ligate these two great vessels and then we cannulate them and connect them to the heart-lung machine. This is a remnant of the arterial and the venous ends of the heart during embryonic development. And the heart is in situ in the fibrous pericardium. And if I were to put my finger like this behind, then it stops here. This is the region of the oblique pericardial sinus, which gets filled with fluid. So these are the two important spaces inside the pericardial cavity. So these are all the structures which I wanted to show you, both outside and inside the heart. And if you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. Have a nice day.